past the hour. We're busy talking, but I think everybody was busy talking to somebody, so you didn't feel like you were just sitting there waiting. It's good to have fellowship coming together in the believing body of Christ. Many members, one body, one spirit, in unity. We come together tonight to worship the Lord, to praise Him, and exalt Him, and we're happy that we have the opportunity. It's exciting to see doors open. God's doing great new things, wonderful things. It's fun to see Ricky here. Missed his face around here. Yes, he was quite a fixture, and then here he is. It's sitting in the same place too, so that everything just feels in order again. Praise God. Well, let's just open in prayer. Lord, we're in this place because of You. We come here because of You. We are hungry for Your presence. We're hungry for Your truth. And we ask, Lord, that You would touch us as we cry out to You, answer our prayer. Come into this place, Lord. Be exalted. Be exalted. We know that You travel on the praises of Your people. And as we sing and exalt You and lift You up, it creates a kind of a conduit between heaven and earth, a channel through which Your glory descends. And that's exactly what we want, Lord, as we praise You tonight, as we sing to You, as we pray and communicate. Let heaven form right here in this room, Lord. Let the atmosphere of the throne room be here with us in this room. Be exalted, Lord. Be high and lifted up. We invite You to do whatever You want to do in this room. We're not going to stop You. We're not going to limit Your access to our hearts. In fact, we open up and we ask that You would go deep, Lord, tonight. Go deep into us. Challenge us with thoughts and ideas, concepts and dreams, Lord. Lead us to a constant faithfulness to focus on You at all times. Let the weights of this world, the cares of this life, wait outside, because they're not welcome in this sanctuary. And I'm not speaking about a building, but I'm speaking about a moment and a time. We sanctify, we hallow this hour, this moment, this time to have an encounter with You and without You. You're wonderful, Jesus. Speak tonight to everyone in this place. Don't let anyone leave without having heard something from heaven for their lives. In Jesus' name, we pray. If you agree with me, say amen to the Lord. Why don't we stand to our feet? God created by human hands. You are not a God.
Oh.
comfort, Lord. No matter what storm comes, no matter what difficulties or trials we must endure, always with you there's peace. Always with you there's rest, the strength. As soon as we forfeit all of our own natural strength, all of our wisdom and ability, and lay it to the side, this world dresses us in the armor of King Saul, but we're just David. If we would just learn to trust what you give us, not what man puts on us, not what people expect from us, not what this world dictates to us, we lay aside the weapons of this age. We pick up the five smooth stones of the Spirit. But all we need is one, because it only takes one to slay a giant. Jesus, you are our victory. You are our strength. You're the one. We trust you. We trust you implicitly. We trust you entirely. With everything that we are. But we put it all in your hands. Take our lives. Use us. Help us to make the exchange of our filthy rags for heaven's treasure. I know sometimes we don't want to let go, and we see those rags as important. We see those rags as dear. We actually become attached to our filthy rags. We say, we've had this filthy rag from the time we were very young. I've always had this rag. Why would I want to get rid of it now? It's always been there for me. But it's never done any good. And the Lord says, give it to me. Give it to me. Just let go. Let go of your thoughts, your ideas. Let go of your plans, your strategies, your aspirations, and your dreams. Your pride, your arrogance, your selfishness. Just let go of it. And I will give you in its place heaven's treasure. The anointing of the Holy Spirit.
I adore.
blood that was poured out for us at Calvary, the blood that was shed for each and every one. What a great price you paid. What a ransom. Lord, how could you love us that much? Thank God that I serve him with a clear conscience. Sometimes I think, because there's moments moments my conscience is not very clear. There's clouds and there's darkness. We can come to him. Just like Isaiah. He can take the coal, his holy fire. His holy fire. It's one coming after me who is greater than I am, John the Baptist said. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Not a fire of punishment. He's not looking to burn you in punishment. That is a fire of purity. Holiness as a gift given. A free gift offered to us all. Jesus, we receive your holiness today. Receive your holiness today. I receive your holiness today. Purge my conscience from every dead work. Wash away every weight of iniquity from my inconsistencies and my stupidity. I come to you, Lord, to your throne, and I beg you for forgiveness. I say, Lord, please have mercy on me, a sinner. As I beat my chest, I will not justify myself. I will say to you, I need your purity, Lord. I need your cleansing. Let the Holy One do the work that he did for me already. Let it be realized in my life. Purify. Gift of holiness. righteous obedience.
It's always time to step
higher in you. You may be a new believer. Just wait. Just hang on. You'll understand even all these thoughts that we're expressing. New believers live in a kind of a bliss. A paradise of sorts. That just, they think, wow, this is easy. Yeah, just wait. Scare you, but just wait. Learn now. Trust him. Trust him. Trust him. And if you fall, just get back up again and say, Lord God, help me. There's no justification for religion, you know. Jesus said it clearly. The man who said, thank you that I do all these religious things, he was not justified. The only justification that can be enacted from Jesus to you is when you beat your chest and say, have mercy on me, a sinner. Just admitting your weakness when you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. In due season, he will exalt you. He will lift you up and use you. It says when you realize your worthlessness, he then can lift you up and use you. Sometimes we just need to realize our worthlessness. When you've even done everything you know to do, and have been a good boy or a good girl, he says then, after being successful, call yourself an unprofitable servant. Because the sacrifices that he requires are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. See, because when your heart breaks from your expression of inability, from your admittance of guilt, it cracks open and there's a sweet, fragrant incense that rises from it to the Lord. He loves the smell of penitence. He loves the smell of someone who tells the truth in their heart and faces what they are and knows that without Jesus, we have no hope. I start every day of my life telling Jesus that I have nothing. He is everything. And without him, I will go straight to hell. But with him, I can do anything. And I yield. I yield. I yield. It's all about yielding to the Spirit. Jesus. Thank you. Teach us obedience.
About once a year, usually when the program is about to begin and the students are coming. Sylvia knows exactly what I'm talking about. His hand comes on us and he crushes us. You'd think, oh, he would encourage you and build you up. No, no, no. He don't need you thinking you're something. He wants to break you down so that you can be a proper vessel. See, because we have 12 people who are going to gather in this room for 3 months for me to teach them. And if I'm not shattered and broken into a million pieces, I have nothing to offer them. I can't give from a perspective of pride and I can do this and I am that. No, it happens every year. It started 4.5 days ago. Suddenly, just out of nowhere, dark cloud. You say, a dark cloud, that must be the enemy. No, read your Bible. Out of a black cloud, God spoke to the Israelites. darkness, a thick darkness. God comes at times to bring purity to us, and he will come in a thickness. It's funny because you may have a season before that where everything's just, oh, Jesus, I love you, and Jesus says, I love you too, and there's a lot of pats on the back, and hugs, holy hugs from heaven. But then suddenly something changes, and God gets serious with me, and he says, okay, it's time to grow up. And it's very uncomfortable when the hand of the Lord comes on. Anyway, that's where I am, and I love it. I love being crushed under the hand of God because it's good. It's good. So I'll tell you some of the attributes of this hand when it comes on you. Suddenly, you start having memories of every thought and thing you've done over the last year. Suddenly, every bad thing you've done or thought, even if you dismissed it, it comes back. And you start taking catalog of every notion, every thought, every motive. It's almost like an audit. That's what it's like. It's like a spiritual audit. The Holy Spirit comes and says, let me see the books. And he pulls it out, and if you fudged any numbers, he's going to make you fix it. He straightens out your books. If you have two ledgers, he wants to see both of them. The black one and the white one. That's the way they say it in India. The black ledger and the white ledger. I lived in India for years. There's a lot of corruption, and every business has two ledgers. The visible money and the invisible money. But the Lord, we do that in our conscience sometimes, in our souls. We become morally dependent upon a religious idea, and that's the book that we use, that's the legend we believe, but then there's this other corrupt side of us that we let, and we all do it. So I have no judgment, and don't judge me if I'm telling you about this. This is my personal life. But we all go through this, but there's a time of reckoning. If there is not, it's a sign that God does not love you, it says in Hebrews. Because if he loves you, he chastens you. And that's a good time to come under the chastening hand of the Lord. And as I said, as a program, we have students coming. We're getting ready to start the program this summer. I'm very excited about those students that are coming. And everything that can go wrong is going wrong. Every year, it's the same thing. Everything that can fall apart, it's falling apart. Everything. And it's like when we're getting ready for the program, every year, everything, like we try to make a step, but we take a step forward and five steps back. And we get a step forward and five more steps back. But it'll be just like it is every year when we do it. At the last minute, as everything comes together, he's going to give us like 50 steps forward. And everything will work out and it'll all be fine. But in the interim, you are changed and you grow up. And I'm excited about it. I'm going to talk in a minute about walking in obedience to God's instructions. Before I do that, I want to take up our offering tonight. We appreciate your gifts, the work that we're doing. And my wife is gone on the 28th. She'll be heading to Cambodia, Phnom Penh. And we are setting up more stuff there. We have two families there. Of course, you know most of what's there. But we're doing more and more and more and more. And I suspect that probably half of our class this year will end up as full-time missionaries in Cambodia. I just have that feeling that there are some of those guys, that's it. God's going to take them and put them there. And I'm excited about that. I want to arrange for some basic Khmer classes also during the program. For them to learn basic communication. Jamriksua, Jamriknia, the simple. You have to talk to your nose when you speak Khmer. It's a pretty little language. And we're going to give just the basic instruction. That's what I think I'm going to do this year, is have different languages, primers for each of them. Have someone help us come in and do Mandarin. Who wants to, any volunteer teachers for Mandarin? All we want is basic hello, goodbye, and how are you? You're the simple, anybody that speaks any manner would be able to do that for us. I can handle the Bahasa part. I speak enough Bahasa, we can do that. Tony's coming in. I'm gonna have him, while he's here, do Japanese. Just basic Japanese. And it's gonna be fun. All the things the Lord is doing. But anyway, we thank you for your gifts, the money that you give for the works that we're doing, all these nations that we're going into, and for support for the local ministers. You also are funding people here locally, and also missionaries that are out in the nations. And gifts come from, I know Paul's group for my son on occasions. This is my son in Tokyo, and he's very appreciative of that. And we my son is the we call in America, the bottom of the totem pole. He's the bottom of the barrel. We support everybody else first. When you think, why? He's your son. Wouldn't you put him first? No, quite the opposite. My son will survive no matter what, because he's my son. You can cut him off entirely. He's going to make it. He's been raised his whole life to do that. That's all he's ever known, his missions. He's okay. So we leave him last. And he'll even write and say, any money this month, Dad? And I'll say, no, we gave it all away. We gave it to other missionaries. He's like, oh, that's cool. You know, it'll come, because his whole life he's seen that. But we do give to him, and we support him and help him. But he's coming, and I'm looking forward to him being. I'm going to have him minister when he comes in and preach one of the services, because he's been getting a lot of experience. He's done regular meetings and teaching there in Tokyo. And so I'm looking forward to hear the word of the Lord from him. So anyway, with this offering we pray for. Father, thank you for the gifts that come. I ask that you would speak to our hearts about what we're supposed to give. And we will obey you. And the very title of our message is Walking in Obedience to God's Instructions. So what are your instructions about our giving? We want to do what you lead us to do. We know, Lord, that you're not deceived. You will not be mocked. Whatever a man sows, he will also reap. So we have that principle. If we give, it will come back to us. And I pray, according to those principles, Lord, that you would give back to each who give. Multiply it back to them. But bless this opportunity for us to offer a sacrifice to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to pass that bucket around. We're not going to take too long for the message. We had just such a sweet time of worship in the presence of the Lord. We're going to go into this, and we may skip through some of the slides, so just so we get ready, if I tell you, just move on, we'll do that. God wants us to follow His instructions. You know, I bought a bookcase from IKEA and did not follow the instructions closely enough. It cost me time and energy. I eventually got it right, but I wasted resources. You know, it has a lot to do with those crazy little locking bolts and mechanisms, and if you don't put the little thing in there first before you put the piece together, it's not there to catch the thing, and you gotta take it back apart. And if you'd read the stupid instructions to begin with, then you stupidly would have done it not the way you did, but you would have actually done it right from the beginning. So I want us to see three key issues concerning obedience to the Lord's commands. And when we ignore these things, we waste time and energy and fail to do what God wants us to do. My goal is to please the Lord in all things. Do we agree?
Yes.
Don't you want to please the Lord? Well, He wants obedience. Obedience. Carrying out the word and will of another person, especially the will of God. A definition for obedience. To obey means that if I ask you to do a thing, you do it. There's general obedience, and then there's specific obedience. God wants specific obedience. He wants you to do exactly no more, no less. You may do a little more every now and then, that's fine, but really, He just wants you to do what He's asking you to do. Be faithful in what He's put in your hand. You do that, and you're, I know, I love it, because when the Lord tells me what to do, I know exactly what I have to do, because He tells it to me in services. He wants me to do a Wednesday night, a Sunday night, a Saturday morning, and a Saturday midday meeting at GMB. He tells me those services, and that makes it easy for me to serve because I know what I have to do. Then the program comes along, and He wants me to do all the things I just mentioned, and also another 5 hours a day, 4 days a week on top of that. And if that's not enough, I'm connecting with some ministries in town, and I'm going to be doing another, in the same time the program's going on, I'm doing about 15 hours of worship seminars. Just add to the mix. If that's not enough, there's a big prayer movement coming, and they're wanting to use me as one of the key worship leaders in that whole movement of all the they've recognized some worship skills, and they're trying to get me to be, and I'll be happy to serve the pastors, but so I get to add that to the plate too. So pretty soon those activities, for me to be obedient, it's going to take a lot out of me, but I just want to obey and do what God called me to do. Carrying out the word and will of another person, not my own will. I wouldn't choose to run myself ragged. And if I do things of my own strength, of course, then I could run myself ragged. But if I do it in the anointing, I will actually find it to be entertaining and restful. No matter how busy you get, if you're doing it in the Spirit, you feel okay. In both the Old and New Testaments, the word obey is related to the idea of hearing. Obedience is a positive, active response to what a person hears. You listen, you obey. I like what Paul Yonggi Cho says, what's your success to making the largest church in the world? He said, I pray and I obey. You know, they wanted some great revelation. And I asked him, no, but tell us, what's the system? How did you? He said, what do you do? And he says, I pray and I obey. That's it. Literally, goes in his office, prays, he gets instructions, he hears from God, and he implements those simple one or two things that God said for that day, and he just does it without question. That's how he developed the largest church in the world. When they have meetings in Paul Yonggi Cho Church, especially, I remember, they have a whole line of doors on one side of the sanctuary and a whole line of doors on the other side of the sanctuary, so the entire mass of people can slide out like a griddle cake coming out of a pan. And the next service comes in so they can put the tens of thousands just that flow through. They could go out and come in, go out, like seven services on a Sunday. You know, they just come out and come in, go out and come in. Largest church in the world. How did he do that? He prayed and he obeyed. God summons people to active obedience to his revelation. Three things about obedience that I'm going to look at here. Number one is this. The little things count. The little things. Do you hear the expression that God is in the details? It's true. God is in the details, especially in what he's telling you to do. That's why when people get confused and wonder what's going on in their spiritual life, I always ask the question, what did God tell you? When I was 17 years old, God told me what to do. It's never changed. I'm 45. I'm still doing what he told me. I can tell you everything he told me in the room when I was 17 years old, where I would go, what I would do. He showed me on the maps and the nations and the things. And now there's a lot of things and details that fill in between the lines, but in what he told me, I'm doing it. And I have it outlined in scripture very simply so that I can make sure that I'm doing it. And every once in a while, I go back to that 14th chapter of Acts, verses 21, 22, and 23, to see the three things of my ministry and make sure that I'm doing it. Preaching the gospel, making disciples, training leaders. As long as I'm doing those, that's what he told me. When I was 17 years old, he made it very clear to me. As long as I'm doing in some way those things, he sees it as obedience. Now there's other things, but simple. The little things that he tells me, I need to do it. We see three principles of the test of fidelity concerning the little things. Number one is a mandatory exam, whether we obey or not. Matthew 25:14, again, it would be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. And why did he do this? He did this because there was a mandatory exam. For him to have his servants become useful to him, first he had to check and see, would they be obedient with what he wanted them to do? He gave them instructions. It's not very clear exactly what it is, but everyone knew that if the money was given to them, it was because he wanted them to multiply it, bottom line. And so they received it as a test. He probably purposefully did not go into many details about what he wanted them to do with the money. He just gave it to them and said, okay, here you go. Do something with this. I'm going off. I'll come back and check later. Now, they may not even have been aware of exactly what he was going to do. In one of the parables, because there's a few of them that are similar to this, in one of them it says that he was gone away to take a kingdom, and the people did not like him and did not want him to rule over them. So they were aware. But in some of the parables, we don't really understand if they comprehended what was taking place. And I see this all the time when people... I just shared a story at a church in town about when the Lord told me to simply clean a vehicle. He told me clean a Toyota Land Cruiser that I was watching, and I cleaned it. It was not mine. I was keeping it for someone else, and I cleaned it. As a result of cleaning it, it's a long story, but it ended up being given to me. It gave me the brand new Land Cruiser as a gift, free. And just because I cleaned it, and also because the Spirit of the Lord told the man to do it. But later that Land Cruiser became the vehicle with which I was able to bring in to refugees after a severe storm hit southern Mexico. I was the only person with a vehicle to feed about 65,000 people. And see, obedience gave me a vehicle that caused me to be able to do that. In turn, it opened up a door to me that the people saw me as the Angel Redentor, they called me, the redemptive angel, because I was feeding them, which then led the government officials to invite me to preach the gospel in all the refugee centers where every last person raised their hand to receive Jesus as Savior. Hundreds of people got saved. Hundreds of them. Why? Because I washed a truck. Bottom line, because I washed a truck. None of it could have happened if I hadn't washed the truck. And this is what I said about the little things. There's a test, but you don't always know. I did not know at that time when I looked at the truck sitting in my pastor's front of his house. I didn't look at it and say, you know, if I wash the truck, it'll be given to me and I'll be able to save hundreds of people from hell. So I'll go up. No, you don't know that when the test is coming. Just do what God puts in front of you. Just be obedient. There's always someone watching. The Lord is looking. And remember, refusal to cooperate does not exempt us from this test. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money, thinking that he could be somehow exempt from this test. I just won't take the test. I won't do anything. Well, see, that too is the test, whether you will take the test or not. And if you don't take the test, you fail. It's no different than school. Everybody's going to get tested in the school program. Everybody, if you go to any school, you're going to have to take exams. And so if you decide, I'm just not going to take the test, does that mean you get the pass? Well, they opted out of the test process, so we're just going to let them slide. No, you cannot. It's the same thing with the principles of the kingdom of God. Refusal to cooperate does not exempt us. You're being tested, so get your pencil. Write some answers. Do the things. We reap what we sow. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. After a long time. The settling of accounts is that dark time of accountability when the Lord comes and says, okay, what's going on? What have you done? And you have to tell him what you've done. And I'm always very happy to be able to tell him. And sometimes I don't realize what I've done, because when you start to walk in pure, simple obedience, you take no record of what you've done. You just obey and forget and obey and forget and obey and forget. And you're just going on. And all that really matters is whether or not you have Coke Zero. That's basically my whole life is there a Coke Zero? Is it cold? I'd rather that it be cold. And simple things. Can I make a good cup of coffee in my house? And really, these are the things I'm worried about. But I obey the big things. I just do them, but I don't think about them. And then as time goes by, after a while, I know that the Lord looks, and after a long time, he comes. Simple obedience. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5, now 10. Master said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I've gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Because the master's happy with us when we do what he asked us to do. I'm happy with my children when they do what I've asked them to do. I send my little girl upstairs to clean her room all the time. Sometimes I walk past her door I look in there and it looks like a Barbie Holocaust took place. And I cannot believe it looks, you know, like I don't know, there's disasters on it. And I think, how can one little human being take out that many toys? It must have taken all night. She must have had all night. It's like every clear space of floor sometimes is covered with an object that is a toy or a thing. You cannot even see the parquet floor anymore. And so I usually go to, I tell her. It's so frustrating. Jay, we'll clean your room. Clean your room. And she tries to get out of it, but eventually she goes. When she does go, though, without a lot of coaxing from me, and she cleans it up, I get so excited, I take her ice skating. I get her ice cream, because I think, you're a good girl, she says to me. And it's clean, and I knew all the barbers are just crammed under the bed, but it looks clean. And this is the master's happiness, that we did something according to what he asked us to do. We do what he's asked, what he told us to do. We're not just sitting there. The man with the two talents also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with two talents. I have gained two more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I'll put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Happy with him too. Yeah, he wasn't as productive as the first guy, but the first guy was also granted more resources because the master knew of his abilities. It said, according to their different abilities. He knows what you can and cannot do already. He knows your natural abilities. He's not going to expect you to do what maybe someone else can do. But the reward is the same, the master's happiness. If ultimately we just want to please the Lord, then obedience is the only way that we can do it. And you think, well, I thought it said that faith. It was by faith that we cannot please the Lord without faith. Well, it is, but faith is obedience, because to obey you have to believe what you were told is right and is what you're supposed to do. And that's faith in what has been told to you. Notice that these guys received rewards proportionate to their success. It's important that we realize that there will be a time of reckoning with God when we will be judged, or he will judge our efforts and reward us accordingly. Some are given more and some less. The important thing is to remember that we must be faithful with what we have in hand. It all starts there. With whatever you have within your reach, be faithful with that. I've had people come and say that, you know, brother, we really want to support your ministry. Just as a missionary in the United States, and in our early years, we were going to impoverished nations and we needed funding to get there. We want to support your ministry. And one day when we have more money, we're going to do that. And I said, well, what do you have now? Oh, well, we don't have much. I said, it doesn't take much. I said, why don't you just give whatever you can give, and I'll use it to take care of the lost and dying. I'll do this, I'll do that. I'll even let you know exactly what I'm spending money. I only have a few dollars a month. And I took those few dollars a month from him and showed him. He was so excited about it, and the Lord prospered him and multiplied that. Some same guy ended up supporting us for hundreds of dollars a month to pay for things. But he started with just a few dollars. And we all need to do that. Just whatever we have in our hand, we want to be, do, act, anything at all. The simplest things. Some are given more, some less. The important thing is to remember that we be faithful what we have in our hand. So many people are waiting for more so that they can make a difference, but it will never come if they do not utilize what is in their hand now. You know, I don't have a lot. My whole ministry is based on me talking and me singing. Just talking, that's all I can do. I'm not juggling fiery torches up here. I'm not balancing on a tightrope. You know, I'm not doing anything other than just singing, but that's what I have to offer, and the Lord's actually able to use it, and I'm able to influence people by the words that I speak. Then the man who had received the one talent came. Master, he said, I knew that you're a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Something. Make some effort. Thinking that he's going to somehow respect him for having been wise enough to know that he was just a hard man. And I don't know what he was expecting the guy to say to him or the master. But there will be no excuses for infidelity to the call of God. He expected the servant to do at least something. Interest in the bank would have been received, or would have received some reward. Even if he had done that, even if it just gained 0.005 of a talent, he would have said at least, okay, I'm going to give you 0.005 of a kingdom to roll. He's like over the bathrooms or something. You know, he's a janitor. But that's better than nothing. But he didn't. And that's the thing. We need to make sure that we are obedient. Take the talent from him, he said, and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. And this seems unfair, but this is the way it is. In God's economy, the rich get richer. It takes money to make money in this world, and so is this paralleled in God's kingdom. But you don't have more until you use what you have to make more, and then you take the more that you make and use it to make more. And I'm speaking of spiritual principles, but it's the same in business too. I've seen very rich people make a lot of money very quickly because they had a lot of money to make it with. They could buy the storage building and sell it next week at a $200,000 profit and earn. I've watched that happen. And somebody earned in a week $200,000 in a week by buying and selling. Well, they could have never bought the thing if they didn't have the resources to be able to buy. They had money already. In the spirit, it's like that. You need to have abilities and things that you build up as you go along so that you can spend out of that. Remember that the gifts and anointing of God is like heavenly currency. Number two, and this is the second of the walking in obedience to God's instructions. The second thing about this obedience, to obey is better than sacrifice. Briefly, we read this. And Saul said unto Samuel, yeah, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. And they've gone the way which the Lord sent me. And they brought Agag, the king of Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken or listen than that or the fat of rams. God's not concerned about what you give, how much. In this case, Saul told Samuel his reasoning for not having obeyed, thinking that he would listen. See, initially, Samuel brought the word of the Lord to Saul, the king, and said, you shall go to the Amalekites and utterly and completely destroy them and Agag and kill every living thing. Specific detailed instructions. But he went anyway, and instead of killing every living thing, he killed most, but he kept all the best, the fatted cattle and calves, and also he kept the prettiest sheep, and with the excuse that he was going to use it to offer as an offering to the Lord, and he spared Agag. He did what he was told to do, go destroy the Amalekites, but he didn't complete exactly what the Lord told him to do. You see how subtle it is. Simple obedience. It was so much easier. It would have been so much easier just to kill everything. You don't have to keep track of what's alive and what's dead. Just kill everything. But he didn't. We see the same thing happen with poor Moses. I feel so sorry for Moses not having been able to go to the promised land. Why? Because he didn't exactly obey what God told him to do. God told him to command that water come out of the rock. He didn't. He hit the rock with his staff in anger. And he, by doing it, failed to demonstrate the holiness of the Lord in an adequate fashion. He used his own guesswork to decide how, based upon his anger, and it so displeased the Lord, that simple, and that seems like a simple little thing, but it would have been simpler to do exactly what God said to do. What did God tell you, Moses? Saul, what did Samuel tell you? Exactly what did he say? If you'd forced him, he would have said, yeah, he told me to kill Agag. Well, why'd you keep him alive? Yeah, he told me to kill all the animals. But why did you keep them alive? Because first he tells him, look, I did what you told me to do, Samuel. Job done. I did exactly what you said. Oh, yeah, well, if you did, then what is this lowing of cows I hear and the bleating of sheep? Why are these animals still alive? And why is Agag alive? Because he had Agag brought and he killed him himself to be done with it. This is the problem, and this is what it means to obey is better than sacrifice. We use that scripture all the time, but this is the context it was in. He didn't care. It did not matter what he thought. He second-guessed the command of God. That's the biggest sin with many believers, is God tells them to do something, but they adjust the plan according to what's comfortable for them or what they think is best. Who are you to second-guess God? And I've been guilty of doing it before. And it always ends up in failure. I decide, God telling you what to do. It's a simple plan. Albeit radical and requiring sacrifice, it's pretty simple what he's told me to do. And when I don't do it and come up with an amended plan, I'm disobeying, ultimately trying to say that I'm doing what God called me to do, but it's not. What did God tell us to do? Saul rushed ahead of God's plan, did things out of order. He had his reasons to offer the sacrifice. You know, we always have reasons to disobey. When you ask any child, why did you not? They'll give you good reasons why not, won't they? Why didn't you clean your room? Because I. And then here comes the excuses. I needed to help Mama in the kitchen. Little angel had to help Mom. Mom would have never made it without the little angel helping. And so therefore, certainly, never clean your room again. You are a saint. No, there's always a reason why. And I find this to be true amongst us as believers too. Saul had his reasons why he didn't obey, but they didn't hold water. We always have reasons why. Disobedience is commonly logical to our natural minds. Makes sense. And therefore, we easily are led to disobey. Because sometimes disobedience is wiser according to the standards of this world. In fact, when it comes to God calling you to do things for his kingdom, almost always the wisdom of this world will talk you out of it, because it's not wise for you to obey God. Obedience often seems to be illogical. To do the thing God told you to do is ridiculous. It's crazy. Eliza found out all about that. She had to obey God, go to Mexico. She was actually told, it can't possibly be God. Can't be God. Nobody's ever heard of an Indonesian going to Mexico as a missionary, a Singaporean going. That's just crazy. She could have listened to that and said, I guess you're right. No, but she's God. The question was, what did God tell Eliza? God said go. So she went. And she had a wonderful time, and she's looking forward to going back, and we're looking forward to sending her back. She'll be here with us for a while, but she's going to obey the Lord. Right, Eliza? Yes. Hallelujah. That's Spanish for hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you know how you say hallelujah in Hindi, in India? Hallelujah. Ricky, what is it in Italian?
Hallelujah.
Yeah, so you say.
Exactly.
How much simpler it would have been for Saul to wait in obedience for the man of God to come. Now, this is talking about the story, and we're kind of skipping around, but God waited and delayed the prophet Samuel to see if Saul would do or not do what he wanted to do. This is referring to the story when the sacrifice had to be done before they could go into battle, and Saul and Samuel arranged the time for Saul to lead the Israelites into war, and Samuel said, I'm coming, but he delayed days, and it drove Saul crazy. And Saul just decided, and he already knew that he was supposed to wait for Samuel, and you do not offer the sacrifice without Samuel to be there. You say, well, how did he know that? He had been told repetitively, even, you remember all the way back when he was anointed as king, the first time when he lost his father's donkeys, or at least he was looking for the lost donkeys, and he ran into that girl when they went to go find Samuel the seer, and the girl told him that Samuel is going up and the people are waiting there to offer a sacrifice because the people will not offer a sacrifice without Samuel because we don't do that and it's not done. It's kind of a superfluous amount of information coming from a village girl. I'm just looking for some donkeys. Why do you have to tell me? Because God was already speaking to him before about an issue that he knew Saul was going to have trouble with. And if you have things that keep coming up to you, and you keep on hearing these things, pay attention to what you're hearing. God's speaking to your disobedient, rebellious heart, trying to tell you through different avenues where you were wrong and trying to adjust you before the real test comes and you get in serious trouble. And that's why it would have been much simpler if he just waited for Saul. But he got frustrated. God waited and delayed the prophet Samuel to see if Saul would follow instructions. Remember, it's all a test. And you're taking an exam. Your exam. Saul was told this long before he was ever king, as I said about this girl. God does not test us on what we do not know. Saul knew, but was he really listening? And remember, the people who were chosen by God and used are of the 300 that scoop the water and with discernment and drink it and do not plunge their faces down into the muddy brook. The ones who exercise more discernment, more finesse, take the time to think, comprehend, wait, see, let the Lord lead you. When you are sure, you obey. You obey quickly. But before that time, just wait and see. Do things according to what the Lord says. That's why I say number three, and we're finishing with this one. Timing is everything. This is the story of Jesus. We're almost done. After this, Jesus went around in Galilee, purposely staying away from Judea because the Jews there were wanting to take his life. That's a good reason to stay away. If there were a group of men in Sembalun that wanted to kill me, I would not go through Sembalun. I would get on the Green Line and go all the way over to Jurong East and go all the way back up to Woodlands if I wanted to. Just stay away from Sembalun. But when the Jewish Feast of Tabernacles was near, Jesus' brother said to him, you ought to leave here and go to Judea so that your disciples may see the miracles you do. No one wants to become a public figure and acts in secret like this. Who wants to do this would act in secret. Since you are doing these things, show yourself to the world. For even his own brothers did not believe in him. Therefore, Jesus told him, the right time for me has not yet come. For you, any time is right. And he was saying that because they didn't care. He says, the world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify that what it does is evil. You go to the feast. I'm not yet going up to this feast because for me, the right time has not yet come. It's two times he said it. Having said this, he stayed in Galilee. However, after his brothers had left for the feast, he went also. Not publicly, but in secret. Now, at the feast, the Jews were watching for him and asking, where is that man? And I always look at this when it comes to my thought about timing, because here he is told by his disciples, or not his disciples, his brothers, he's told, go, why don't you go? And he says, no, my time has not yet come. And no sooner than they walk out the door, he says, okay, my time has come. That could it be based on even minutes? Yes, it can be based on minutes. I've had several occasions where the Lord's told me to do a thing and I knew not to do it. I'm often faced with things that I must do, but feel that I should wait. I believe in not putting off for tomorrow what I can do today, but sometimes I feel that the time is not full. I do like to get things done, and if it's going to be done, let's just do it. But sometimes the Lord says, wait. There's a time, and there's an anointing and an unction given to do the things that will not be released. See, we're working according to a heavenly connection, and he doesn't always grant you the supernatural abilities that you need to do a thing before the time of them being done. And I know this from experience. Trying to do things before the time and it just like banging my head against the wall. Every worship session, every message I prepare, everything I do, I know that there's a time that I need to do it. You know, the Bible reading I do it on Thursdays. Tomorrow's my Bible reading recording time when I record all the scriptures that I put on Facebook, the daily Bible reading. And I can't do that any other day. I've tried to do it on other days and I have to do it in like 50 takes because I keep making mistakes. If any other day but Thursday, it's the strangest thing. But when, as soon as I sit down to do it on Thursday, I feel a heat come over my body. And I do them in one or two takes for the whole reading without stopping. Smooth as glass. It just, something comes on me and I can just read and read and read. Why? Because it's an anointing. That's the time for me to do that thing. And as I say, I can't always explain this feeling. And sometimes judged as a procrastinator. Concerning my desire to work in Vietnam, I have work that we're going to do in Vietnam. Undoubtedly some of the strongest manifestations of power I've ever felt in confirming God's Spirit on me to go to Vietnam as a missionary has been surrounding the moments, these supernatural things, when talking about Vietnam, touching maps of Vietnam, being completely consumed by the glory of God. There's an anointing on me to go. And you say, well, why aren't you going? Because he won't let me go yet. It's not yet. But I like talking about it because one day in the future, you're going to see me in Vietnam doing some amazing things. Because, you know, he always said he was going to go to Vietnam. But I can't go. You see, if I did make myself go and went beforehand, what would happen? It would be done in the name of Stephen and in Stephen's strength. I'd go around praying for sick people, be healed in the name of Stephen. It's not going to work. Because God wouldn't be with me until the time is for me to do it. And I know concerning many things, there's so many things I want to do that I cannot do until the Lord releases. And that is a characteristic of obedience. The timing is so important. Always remember that ultimately we will not be assessed by the standard of greatness or overall achievement, but more importantly, obedience. There are people who do little things their whole life, but they'll do them in succession over a long period of time, and overall will have produced more fruit in the kingdom than the people who were only waiting to do great and wondrous things and didn't do the little things along the way. We saw these three principles. The little things count. Number two, to obey is better than sacrifice. And number three, timing is everything. Amen. That's it for the message tonight. I want us to pray. Would you stand up with me? It's all about yielding to the Spirit of God, obeying Him. Jesus. Lord, teach us to obey You in everything, to do exactly what You've told us to do from the beginning. Dreams and visions, in messages we hear preached, when other people share testimonies, sometimes we feel Your hand on us and we hear Your voice and You say that we need to do something. God, help us to just simply do the things that come to our spirit, no matter how simple they are, no matter how small, how insignificant it seems to us. Teach us true obedience. Starting with the most basic principles of obedience of Your word, it says, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Are we preaching at all? If not, help us to do that. In any way possible, just find someone that we can share our story with about what Jesus has done for us. Lord, if it's bigger things, maybe we know that we're supposed to be involved in maybe works in another nation, and we think, well, I'm not ready to go there as a full-time missionary. Well, maybe He's not calling you as a full-time missionary. Just visit. I've never gone to a nation thinking I was going to be a full-time missionary.
I've always gone just for a visit to see, and it's only after that that the Lord brought clarity. But I've been to many nations where the Lord, I wanted to be a full-time missionary, and he said, no, I don't want you to be here. See, the thing is, our feelings can deceive us sometimes. We just need to listen. Listen to him. Let his word be a lamp unto your feet. Not just his written word, but the rhema that he speaks to you, the 9 hours on your bed, and your thoughts, and your dreams. Just listen to him. Just listen to him. It's the same with this program that we're doing right now. Every year we find the students that want to come, and then they get cold feet, or they feel like, well, no, I don't know, and something, maybe not, and some people pull out. But it's really a simple thing that has to be done. It's a bridge. The program is like a granting of talents. And he watches during that, will they be faithful? Will they come on time? Will they do the work of the program? And if they do, this shows him a sign that they are able to obey. And so therefore he makes arrangements for them, for their future. He knows, because they've been calibrated, they've been tested and approved. And then the issue of timing comes in. Some of us have been to the program and we're still kind of sitting and thinking, well, I thought I was supposed to do something right away. Now just rest. Just rest and wait. God will let you know when the time comes. It may be quick, though. He does. Just do what he tells you to do. Lord, we want to be obedient to you in everything. Lead us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Did you hear me say amen to the Lord? Let's just end with that song we're singing.
Exactly what you say.
Not adding to it.
Not taking away from it.
Not taking away from it. exactly
what you desire.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Let's give a hand clap.